Before we get started, I wanted to plug a project that my own dear mummy is doing. She is brand new to the world of vlogging, and she's eager to share with people who are interested. She's just getting started, so bear with her while she gets a hang of how it works and upgrades some of her recording equipment. In her words, Daughters of the Black Madonna is a new approach to an ancient belief. If you love the beauty of church and prayer, but hate the patriarchy and dogma, you may really resonate with this channel. Celebrate all things divine feminine, enjoy learning about the connections between pagan holy days and the more recent feast days of the church, and participate in meditations, feminine rosaries, and prayers for female deities and saints. Check out the first couple videos by searching Daughters of the Black Madonna on YouTube, and be sure to like and subscribe. I will include a direct link to her channel in my show notes. Thanks for your support, everyone, and don't forget that she's my mommy, so be nice.
This is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering the Dresden Files, Briefcases, Bigfoot on Campus. In this book, we get to hang out with Irwin Pounder again. And his last name has never felt so relevant. Welcome to Unspoiled. I'm a rolling thunder, pouring rain. I'm coming on like a hurricane. My lightning's flashing across the sky. Welcome to the show, everyone. I am Natasha.
I'm RoShawn.
So, what did you feel about this story overall, ma'am?
You know what? I really like this story. I wasn't sure because, you know, it went a couple of different ways and I was... My goodness.
Jesus Christ.
People are so angry, you guys. Everyone is on their last goddamn nerve and it is Thunderdome out there. That's all I'm saying.
Oh, shit.
But no, I really like this. I wasn't sure a couple of moments throughout the course of the story. I was like, well, I don't know where this is going. But I really liked it.
Good. Yeah, I kind of know what you mean there, because we have, you know, a lovely teenage girl who turns out to be a white court vampire and is fucking his brains out for, like, you know, the last third of the story.
Right.
I was just like,
there's like Harry being like obscenely attracted to her and he can't even control himself. And I'm always like side eyeing it, especially because of the ages. But then you find out it's because she's a white court vampire and you're just like, okay, maybe it wasn't Harry's fault.
Yeah. And but, Harry does feel appropriately like, good God, I need to stop. Like, that is true, sir. You do need to stop.
I appreciated those moments where he tried to, like, check himself whether or not it was successful or not. And then the way it ended, it ended, like, kind of very sweetly. It ended up being a very sweet sort of young love story. And considering what we've been through in the main books, this was a nice little treat.
So did you read the intro for this story?
I did.
So that part where he's like, this is something that will prepare Harry because he will have to deal with fatherhood and figure out how that works as well.
Listen,
and that was the thing that I was explaining, because a lot of people were like, you guys didn't cover such and such. And I was like, no, because he was about to ruin that shit.
And it's only in the intro, because none of that comes up in the story.
Yep.
So, like, what is he doing?
I was super, super salty about that. Like,
yeah.
Mostly what irritated me was that I strayed very close to having you read this without knowing, and it wasn't until somebody else informed me, hey, there's kind of a spoiler in that intro, and I realized how close I could have come, and that really irks me.
for no reason, because there's literally never a moment in the story itself where anyone is like, Harry, you know, it's going to be like this for you.
Yeah.
You know, there's none of that. It's only in the intro where he mentions it, and that is just shoddy.
Yeah.
Writing. I-M-O.
I was like, what? You are O. Oh, I get it. But yeah, so I just, because, you know, I guess at this point in the story, Harry has not yet found out that he has a daughter, so it doesn't come into play. Well, then don't fucking mention it, though.
Yeah, why would you? Yeah, exactly.
Don't say anything.
It's fine. But yeah, I really did like this story, and I thought it had a really sweet ending. I love the optimism of, you know, these two kids being able to go out into the world and make a life for each other, and that they are really meant to be together,
mm-hmm.
and that they were well suited to be together because of Irving's ability to withstand Connie's, you know,
hunger.
Hunger. Thank you, because I was mm-hmm. floundering. So, yeah. And also, you know what? I enjoyed the convention of the way he tells the story, which is him talking to a police officer and telling the officer the story.
Yeah.
So we get these cute little, like, little interludes where the cop is like, oh, you are so full of shit. This story is crazy. Yeah. Tell me more.
I really, like, when that is a very effective opener when the cop is just like, so, we found you in the middle of an orgy.
Mm-hmm.
There
mm-hmm.
was a car on the fourth floor of the building. One of the walls was missing. There was blood everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Explain. And I was yep. like, explain.
I would very much like to hear this explanation.
Go ahead, Clarissa.
And then Harry is like, okay, well, first of all, there's all this blood, but did you find anybody that was hurt?
I love that fucking, well, show me a body. Oh, you can't. Can right? you?
Because then I'm like, I'm immediately like, the fuck happened to all the bodies? Like, I don't doubt for a second that there was a bunch of bodies, because I know what this world is, you know, I know what Dresden Files is about. So I know there's bodies.
Yep.
So when he says there are no bodies, I'm just like, oh, who took the bodies, y'all?
Oh,
and then eventually you find out like what happened, and you're just like,
And I also like, part of my enjoyment of this story as well is just enjoying Irwin as a character so much.
Yes.
Irwin is like, you know, obviously let's add, maybe like 10 years to his age here, but let's say if he were older, he would come second only to Sonya in terms of my personal interest.
Ooh.
Because he is such a cinnamon roll good person.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Also, he lifted that bitch with one arm.
He sure did.
And didn't even have to, like shift his body weight for leverage. It was like he picked up a fucking Christmas ornament.
I love when Connie talks about how it is she can't even have feelings for him. And she acknowledges that, like, yeah, no, he's not particularly handsome,
mm-hmm.
but he has an energy about him, which, you know, what she's saying is he's got big dick energy.
Yep. 100%.
You know, they don't call it that, but that is what she is talking about.
Yep.
And I feel like I wish I could relate to the men who are out there. What it means to have BDE.
Yep.
It is not about how you look.
Nope.
It is not about your physique. You know?
It's not about how much fucking money you have.
It is not about how much fucking money you have. It is about the way you carry yourself in the world. And how you treat people. And how you know your worth. Mm-hmm. Because you are a good person. Right?
Yep.
It is so misunderstood and so often misinterpreted right? Yes. Guys think that it is all of these things. And it's not just the guy's fault. Like, there's a lot in pop culture that we attribute to what makes a man attractive, you know? Mm-hmm. And I mean, what can you say? That people write stories. That's what happens. Mm-hmm. But guys, if you know your shit, if you know how to handle yourself, and I don't necessarily mean physically either, like you have to be able to fight 30 guys at once.
Right.
But if you just know who and what you are, and you are comfortable in that, mm-hmm. the panties will fly off.
That's true.
That's all I'm saying. If you're a young man listening to this and you haven't been out in the world yet, listen to an old lady. I'm telling you.
And I think every dude has known some guy in their life that they're like, he's a good dude. I mean, it's not like I don't see why women like him, but women really like him. And I do not get how it's so easy for him. And there, it's not like what I'm trying to avoid is the first thing that dudes think is, why do women like this guy? Because he's such an asshole. I'm talking about the guy that you can't figure out why women like him, because there doesn't seem to be anything like stereotypically about him that you would think would attract women. Mm-hmm. But also, you have a respect and a like for this guy as well that you don't know quite where it comes from.
Yep.
And that's what that is.
Yep.
Yeah. It's just there's just something. You can sense it when somebody, as you put it, knows who they are and what they're about and is comfortable. It's just there's a grounded sense of calm around a person mm-hmm. like that, because mm-hmm. they are not constantly trying to reassess yes. the situation that they are in to adjust their behavior to please a person that they are standing in front of.
Yeah.
It's they are being who they are with yep. no apology, and that is just take it or leave it.
Yeah, and they are that in every situation. Mm-hmm. You know, they don't change on a whim based on who they are around. And so when this opens, you know, it opens with Harry talking to the officer, who I think his name is Dean.
Is it?
Okay. Yeah. And Harry has been kept behind for questioning. We find out at the end of the book, because everybody else is absconded, he's like, I'll stay and, you know, clean up the mess. And he's telling this cop, first he tells him, you're not going to believe me, but I'm going to go ahead and tell you what happened. So the story is sort of framed with Harry recounting all of this, and a cop, like I said, you know, every once in a while is just like, get the fuck out of here. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. What? You're crazy. But really what's happening is Harry has been, I think, invited or asked to come and talk to River. His full name is something really awesome.
Oh,
Shoulders as wide as rivers. What is it?
I think carries the river in his shoulders. Mm, I think might be good. The one, but let me see if I can. Oh my God. The fucking no mocha. Fuck.
Oh my God. I love that.
Can we stop with the, like, I'm a real man because I don't drink flavored coffee.
No, get the we fuck can't stop with that. We can't stop with that.
I have no respect for it.
It is going to be a thing forever and always. Because black coffee is king for some reason, even though that shit is disgusting.
Nasty.
I know. It's like a person who, you know, you also have worked like as a barista for years on and off at different places. And people will be like, well, if it's a really good quality coffee, you don't need cream and sugar. Fuck that.
Yeah. I mean,
I don't care where those beans could have grown in the ass of a fairy, and you still need coffee and cream.
I like how you say that, like that was supposed to be the best possible place that it could be grown. Man, that was your idea? That was the best thing you could think of?
A fairy's ass seems like a really great place, you know, for coffee that doesn't need cream and sugar.
I will say that I have had lattes in which I'm like, oh, this really doesn't need sweetener, but that I've has that. Milk in it at exactly. the very least.
Yeah, if you get a latte that's made well, you really don't need, you know, sugar.
Mm-hmm.
In my opinion,
agreed.
But coffee, come on, y'all, quit yeah. playing. Don't lie in my face.
Strength of a river in his shoulders.
There it is.
Yeah.
Oh, I love that.
It's good.
So he's meeting him, and it's very similar to the other two stories, you know, where they meet in the woods. And he's willing to pay Harry. He's got a gold nugget that he tosses him.
Mm-hmm.
And Harry doesn't accept it and says, for payment, I want you to meet your son.
Yeah.
And Rivers is feeling a way about that. But Harry is sticking to his guns. He's like, as someone, you know, who lost their father, there is nothing that can replace that.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing you can do, there's nothing I can do that makes up for your absence in his life.
Mm-hmm.
And it gets a little bit tense because, you know, Rivers is a big guy with lots of magic and power, you know, and this is a little tense for Harry to be, you know, making demands on how Rivers deals with his child.
Yeah.
But he eventually agrees to Harry's terms. But we don't know when. Like, you know, we don't get like, okay, I'm going to show up on Tuesday and we'll all sit down and talk. We don't, you know. But we do know that he agrees that he will see his son. And Rivers is concerned for his son because he has gotten a sort of a prophecy, I guess.
He had a nightmare, but you know, his dreams mean more than the average dream.
Like he's got sort of, and he's concerned that his son's life is in danger, and this is why he is asking Harry to go check up on him at school at the university in Oklahoma.
Mm-hmm.
And I have not been to Oklahoma. I think you have.
Oh yeah, I live like 10 minutes outside not far, of Oklahoma. Right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It is not a place that I personally really feel like I'd ever want to go.
No, it's not. It doesn't have much to recommend it, I will say.
but Harry goes to the school, and there's a really fun description for any of us, and I feel like a lot of us have probably experienced this when you show up on a college campus, how it just makes no sense.
You know? Yeah.
like you get there and all the buildings have dumbass names and you're looking at your little, you know, fold out map that you got trying to figure.
Yeah, I really like, and part of that is always because like they add buildings on.
Mm-hmm.
And because like universities always wind up becoming larger than they intended they really to be do. In the first yep. place. And it makes me think of, like, the difference between living here in Texas versus living in Connecticut, where in Connecticut, they built streets for stagecoaches before they built streets for cars and whatnot,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
because it was settled so much earlier.
Right.
And thus, the streets in Connecticut are a disaster. Everything is like twisted around one another and there's no room for anything and there's no, and then you come down to Texas and everything is so new and even the stuff that's old is new.
Right, right.
And there's like so much room and the shoulders on the highways are enormous and there's like big delivery entrances to the restaurants so that the trucks can back in, no fucking problem. And that's sort of how I think of college campuses as all being like old cities. That they started off thinking too small, and now they're paying for it.
Right.
And everybody else has to just
figure that shit out.
Whatever the fuck they're thinking, and try and act like that shit makes some sense.
Philly has a lot of the same problem because it was so, you know, such an old city.
Mm-hmm.
The one good thing that Philadelphia did that a lot of other Northeast cities didn't do was William Penn and his grid, right? So that makes Philadelphia relatively easy to navigate because the bulk of the city is on a grid.
Right.
And you have streets that run north-south, and you have streets that run east-west, and there's only a handful that stray from that. You know, we have a couple of, like, streets that run diagonally, like Passyunk Avenue or Ridge Avenue. But for the most part, in the heart of the city, it's a basic grid, and it is impossible to get lost.
Mm-hmm.
But if you happen onto any of the college campuses that are in Philadelphia, and we have a couple of really, really large universities here, those rules go out the window.
Yeah.
Like, Penn just does whatever the fuck it wants to do, and it's swallowing up neighboring neighborhoods. Same with Drexel. That was weird. Same with Drexel. And Temple University has done the same thing, where they just sort of start to creep out and absorb the areas that are surrounding the campus. So that when you get to the schools, you're just fucking like, whatever, dude. You just have to figure that shit out.
Yeah.
It makes no sense whatsoever.
Yeah. I do enjoy, even if you've gone to a new campus, y'all know. People don't think things through when they design them. They really don't. They have somebody who's like, oh, this looks really cool. We're going to make this school look state-of-the-art. Yeah, but is it state-of-the-art? Is it set up in a way that makes any fucking sense?
Nope.
No, but, like, the ceiling is curved and it's all glass. Thank you. That's very helpful.
Super helpful. So, Harry shows up and he has Irwin's itinerary, right? So he thinks this is going to catch him in class. But he's not in any of his classes. So he goes to, I know, right? I was disappointed.
Bad boy.
So he heads to the football field, and that's where he is. Cause it turns out he's on some kind of, he's on the team. He's on the football team. And he runs into Connie. Yeah. So,
Connie has an effect.
She does. And it takes Harry completely by surprise. And it takes a few moments for him to realize what's happening to him and how it's familiar. And he thinks about the time he was with Lara. And he's like, oh, wait, I know what this is.
Yeah, and he finally sees her eyes, like, being, like, they're flecks of silver. And it's not until way later that he realizes she doesn't even know what's happening.
Yeah, yeah. This was really upsetting. And I couldn't remember if we knew this specifically about how white court vampires aren't told what they are until after their first kill.
I believe we did because, remember in the book with the porn stars?
Yes.
Harry gets left in a bathroom with Thomas's, like, younger sister or cousin or something.
Oh, right.
And she isn't aware of what she is.
That's right. That's right.
That had been an attempt to kill Harry because that's it's always fatal.
You're right. Okay. So that is a thing we know.
Mm-hmm.
So when he sees this in Connie and recognizes it, Harry is like hip to it right away. And he realizes that, and it comes up later in the story, that most likely her father has sent her to college to, you know, bang the first guy she runs into. It will be her first kill. She'll turn. And this is just the way we do things in this family. But before we get to that, after he meets Connie and he sees Irwin and they go out to dinner, and they're very cute together.
They honestly are.
They're super cute.
Like, I find couples a difficult thing to read a lot of the time. I find them to often be very boring. And this is a couple that I'm like, I would hang out with them and enjoy myself.
I feel the same. It is, oh my God, especially when you get to the end, right? She's able to calm him and kind of restrain him just with her voice and her words. But that's later. So they have this dinner, and she's being very flirty, you know, but she doesn't even, Connie is not even aware of where this flirting comes from, right? Yeah. Like, this is, as far as she's concerned, this is just her. Mm-hmm. And how she's always been. And Harry kind of suggests that there might be something going on with Connie and that she is either not what she seems or more than she seems. And he gets so upset.
Oh, man, he gets so mad.
He can't even be here anymore. And he wants to leave. And he demands that she leave with him. And she's like, I'm grown.
Oh, my God, I love her.
I love her, too.
I'm not your pet.
I'm not your pet. Listen, I was here for it. But it's so sweet because he immediately says something like, I don't mean to be mad at you, but I'm really frustrated and angry, and I probably need space. Mm-hmm. Right? So mm-hmm. there's like a level of maturity and honesty in the way they talk to each other.
Yeah.
Already at this young age, which I think there's like freshmen or sophomores in college, they're mm-hmm. kids.
Yeah.
Like that they have managed this level of openness and communication is so remarkable to me. You know, because I didn't have it at that age.
Lord knows. Same.
You know, so I started rooting for them super early.
Yeah, I also really like that despite the fact that she's super flirty, it does not seem that Irwin is threatened by that at all.
Not at all.
There is no jealousy coming off him. He seems to just be delighted with her. Yep. He knows who she is, and that's how mm-hmm. she is, and he's just fine with it.
Yeah. I loved that Harry mentions that, too, that he notices that. Mm-hmm. And again, at their age, mm-hmm. you know, this is men and women, too, but men will carry their insecurity and jealousy, you know, and their need to dominate well into the middle age and longer if you fucking let them.
It's true.
And that he is already at a point where he recognizes that the woman that he loves is actually her own person, and he does not need to be threatened by how she exists in the world mm-hmm. because he's secure, you know. Yep. Is just, to me, like, it's just remarkable.
That's something that I, like, there are so many things that you see, both in, like, media, but also from friends in life, where a personality trait will cause somebody to fall for another person. But then once they are in the relationship, that same personality trait suddenly becomes a liability. And it's like, mm-hmm. but you knew this about them. You knew who they were the whole time. Why is this suddenly a problem now?
Yep.
Very frustrating to watch it happen.
Secretly, we always believe that we can change the things that we, you know, we'll meet a person, we'll see them as for who they are, and then decide, well, these things I can tweak.
Well, and that's what I mean, is that you go into those relationships usually never thinking that you would want to tweak that thing.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
You know, that was a thing that you specifically loved about them, is that they are so charming and able to, like, flirt the pants off anybody, but you know that it's, like, really harmless.
Right.
And then once you get into it, all of a sudden, that has it's a whole different vibe, and it hits different now, and you're like,
And that's true.
It's just, it's a bummer, because I know that for myself, I've had that happen a couple times where I've been like, I can see objectively, I am not being fair right now. I know that this is not something that I'm allowed to feel this way about. And yet, here I am, and I don't really know what to do with this.
Right. Yeah, that's true. Is that how it happens?
Mm-hmm.
You know, we see someone when we first meet them and we think, oh, I'm all good with all of it.
Right.
And then we get into it and we're like, yeah, I'm not so good with this part and that part and the other part. Let me see how I can change it real quick. So, they're at dinner and Irwin gets really upset and he needs to go because he's just like not trying to hear what Harry is suggesting about Connie, even though nothing has come out just yet.
Mm-hmm.
And then her father shows up.
Yeah, this is
outside
weird,
of the restaurant. This is... So he's a fancy pants white court vampire. And he's got a limo and ghouls, because of course he does. And he comes and
he's
he tells...
He's so popular with the ghouls.
Oh my god, these fucking white court vampires, y'all. And he is basically just like, get in the car. We need, you know, we need to talk. And she initially is kind of like, nah. And then things get a little hairy. And, oh my god, I just heard it.
I'm sorry.
And, I should mention, too, that when they all got to dinner, because Connie had met Harry while Irwin was still playing, so when they all get together, she realizes that they know each other.
Mm-hmm.
And he explains that, you know, this is a gentleman that, you know, my father sends to save me sometimes.
Oh, God. I love how much has happened, and yet Harry is still startled later when Irwin is like, magic is real, you're a wizard.
Listen.
And he's just like, wait, what? I'm like, Harry, come on.
Right.
Fuck.
He's Irwin is like, yeah, I saw the paradise online. Harry is like, the interwebs, the what now?
What does he say? I need to become more internet-y.
Internet-y, yeah.
He's just like, yeah, you do.
That's what you need to do. You need to be more internet-y. So there's a brief discussion about Irwin's father and Harry's connection, and he explains to Connie that, you know, his father is absent from his life, but sometimes this man shows up. And she's
one way to
like,
say it.
You know, she's just like, I guess.
Yeah.
So her father shows up and he's terrible because of course he is.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, I was just thinking about like, I can't decide whether or not I find him to be too much of just a copy of Lord Wraith. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
When we met Lord Wraith, like, because he feels so similar in some ways, but we didn't really get to know Lord Wraith that much. So I think that there's not really that much danger there in making him too similar, because Lord Wraith was really only much of a factor in one book.
Right. My interpretation of reading this was that he was styling himself after Lord Wraith. In the way that if you have a court of people, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you're nobleman, because Harry tells this guy, what's his name, Brandle Hill?
Something weird.
Something
like
close
that.
Like that. Harry recognizes him as having been, you know, at the
deeps.
God. Yes, the thank deeps. You. So I imagine that, like, if I'm a mid-level nobleman, I'm going to, you know, behave as the way I think I see the higher-ups behave. I'm going to style myself in that fashion.
That's true.
And it feels very, like, all for show, and that he doesn't really have much, or as much, you know, to back it up as a Lord Wraith may have had.
So what you're saying is he's a fucking poser.
Basically, he's a poser. And it comes to light when all his fucking ghouls skedaddle.
Oh my god, that's so funny.
But yeah, so he's like, you know, kind of get in the car. You know, we didn't talk about this later. And at one point, Harry had asked, I think during dinner, after Irwin left, you know, he asked Connie, how did they meet?
Mm-hmm.
And she says that, you know, they were at a party, and it sounds kind of like a spin the bottle situation. I'm not exactly sure. But that was their first encounter. And then afterwards, she sort of started to fall more deeply for him.
Mm-hmm.
And later is when we get the idea that she has been sent to school for this first kill. And it just so happens that the person she was with was not mortal, or not human, rather. And so he survived what should have been her first kill.
Mm-hmm.
Which was, you know, how do you plan for that?
Right. And I really love the fact that Harry doesn't put it together either, what's going on. Like,
mm-hmm.
The cop winds up asking him about it when we come back into the framing device.
Right.
And Harry's like, yeah. Exactly. That mm-hmm. was also my problem. And he basically has, he's got so much life force that she can steal as much of it as she needs, kind of.
And it just, like, Harry and the cop talk about the first meeting where it really, for Irwin, just feels like a hangover.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And there's a bit of a callback to the last story where a spell that would have killed someone else basically just put him to sleep for a little while.
Mm-hmm.
So
that guy could get his fucking hair plugs worked.
So there's a standoff with the dad, and there's a lot of, like, you know, fucking dick waving, quite frankly.
Yeah.
And he's like, you have till midnight to get out of here. You know, after midnight, all bets are off. Exactly. And the cop recognizes this Barrowwell's name because he is of affluence in this area. Mm-hmm. He's an oil baron, I think, of some kind. And Harry is like, yeah, of course he is, because vampires like to have money and access and live large. So it makes sense that he would be financially connected.
I love when he says that. And he's like, yeah, vampires like having connections and money. And this dude is like, oh, yeah, unlike me.
Right? Harry's like, fair point. I
never get caught up in silly things like that. Amen, sir.
Right? So, I think there's a mention of Harry calling for a friend to maybe come help him that lives in Dallas. I think his name is Wild Bill or something. And,
I forgot about that.
Yeah. Right. And he doesn't get him, but he leaves a message, and he's not sure what's going to happen with all that because of, you know, the difficulty with having a cell phone as a wizard and so on and so forth. But later in the story, that does come back because he is the one who crashes the car in the fucking dorm.
Oh, my God. I love that so much. Like, what is it that Harry says? Oh, right. That's a classic college prank. It was on the fourth floor. They were trying to keep it fresh. Just, you know, do something a little different, a little bit more creative. And I was like, uh-huh. So, yeah, dick waving, as you say.
Right. So, I'm trying to think.
Sorry, guys, if you can hear Owen. He's going in and out of his office.
Harry makes his way back to the dorm much later, and at this point it is after his midnight deadline, so the father, Barrowhill,
can't remember. I'm trying to get to the spot where his name comes up, but I can't. Oh, yeah, Charles Barrowhill.
Barrowhill.
Yeah.
He is using his energy, his psychic energy, to compel Connie to basically fuck Irwin to death.
Mm-hmm.
And the force of what he is using is so strong that it is just, like, ricocheting throughout the whole dorm. So,
but don't skip over the meet that Harry has with River Shoulders again.
Oh my God, did that happen before this?
Yeah, that's what lets Harry know that he needs to go check on Irwin again. Because Harry goes to tell River Shoulders, you might have gotten a premonition about this girl, but there's nothing to worry about.
Oh, right.
And River Shoulders is like, no, there definitely is, because she's about to do shit differently from her father.
Right. And he's like, they're definitely going to kill him. And they talk about, like, the lie. Oh my God, the lie. And what you do in service of the lie. Like, basically, Barrow Hill must have been told by his father at some point that the person he killed had to happen. This is the only way it can be. Mm-hmm. So then he has to turn around and raise his daughter the same way, because the alternative is to admit that his father lied to him.
Right.
And nobody wants that. And good Lord, y'all, if that ain't the fucking truth.
Yeah, when I was reading this today, I was like, ooh, that is going to feel really relevant in a way that Butcher did not intend.
Right?
But, yeah. Right?
Yeah, like, what we will do to save ourselves from facing the reality that we have been lied to, that we have been participating in a lie and perpetrating a lie, we will go to all these lengths. Mm-hmm. We will let harm come to those we love if we think it is in service to the lie that we are holding on to.
Mm-hmm.
And that shit is such an indictment. And it is so true. It is so fucking true. And Rivers understands that his son has to die in service of this lie.
Mm-hmm.
That there's no other alternative. There's no way that Barrowwill can let his daughter live, let her turn without killing him, because then he has to question the things that he's done and the things that he was told by his father.
Mm-hmm.
Y'all.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this reminds me, one of my spoil me's, I was reading Parable of the Sower, Parable of the Talents by Octavia Butler. And there's a poem in the second book. I'm just going to read it because I found it. It just reminded me of this so much. Beware, all too often, we say what we hear others say. We think what we're told that we think. We see what we are permitted to see. Worse, we see what we're told that we see.
Mm-hmm.
Repetition and pride are the keys to this. To hear and to see even an obvious lie again and again and again. Maybe to say it, almost by reflex. Then to defend it because we've said it.
Mm-hmm.
And at last to embrace it because we've defended it.
Mm-hmm.
And because we cannot admit that we've embraced and defended an obvious lie.
Mm.
Thus, without thought, without intent, we make mere echoes of ourselves, and we say what we hear others say.
Good Lord.
Right? This bitch can write, let me tell you guys.
She really can. Jesus Christ. That's fucking everything right there.
That's all of it.
All of it.
I never thought of it in context of pride before. And then when I saw that, I was like, oh, that's exactly it.
Yep.
They said it, and now they're like, well, I said it, and I can't unsay it. And it's just like, yeah, you can. You can take it back.
Nope. I'd rather fucking just put my head down and commit to the lie.
Mm-hmm.
And save face. Whew. Wow, that's a lot.
Yeah.
Oh, I need to finish those books, but they're so heavy.
They are heavy. Listen, I am not even of the demographic who would be most effective, and it was really tough for me to get through them. So, you know, maybe hold off for right now. Just, but yeah, the idea here that is so interesting to me too is the psychological aspect of this, which I don't feel Butler does a ton. Butcher. I don't feel like Butcher does this sort of thing a whole lot, looking at, like, the psychological motivations behind doing something simply because of the sense of self behind it.
Right, right.
Usually it's about psychological ramifications in regard to somebody who feeds on fear. Somebody, you know, like that sort of psychology that's much right. more linked to magic. And this is just, honestly, it's a very human thing, even though it's yeah. not.
Yeah, no, it absolutely is, though. You know, it's the, you know, and you see it, you know, in a much more pedestrian way with just how we as a society raise our children.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a friend of mine shared a thread, a Twitter thread, and it was a fairly well-known person on Twitter was challenging the idea. I think they said something very basic like, all of y'all who said you were beat as kids and you're fine now, you're not.
Mm-hmm.
And the thread was filled with people who were like, no, I am fine.
Mm-hmm.
And I was reading through it and I was really struck by two things. I was struck by how attached we are to our right to beat our children
mm-hmm.
in the name of discipline or whatever else. And even more upsetting was how attached we are with telling ourselves that the beatings we took don't matter.
Yeah.
That we're fine.
They did us good, if they anything.
They did us good. I'm glad my parents did it. Mm-hmm. You know, because I was X, Y, and Z. And we have not had either the opportunity or the space or the time to reflect on just how damaging it is to have someone who says they love you more than anything else raise their hand to you.
Mm-hmm.
Because to confront that is difficult, and it makes you have to acknowledge some things that are unpleasant to acknowledge.
Mm-hmm.
And this is kind of like that. This is him saying, well, my parents did it to me. You know, I had to go and, like, you know, kill the first person I wanted to have sex with because I cared for them. And then I ended up murdering them and they told me it was how it had to be. So now my daughter has to do it too. And it's that same sort of pathology, that same unwillingness to face the truth of what happened to you. You know?
Mm-hmm.
It's deeply sad in a lot of ways, which is why the ending to the story is so wonderful, because it suggests that they were able to escape this.
Yeah, agreed. I wasn't really sure what to expect with this story if I was going to get a happy ending the first time that I read it. And it's a happy ending that feels like not trite. Which right. is hard to pull off.
Yeah, know? Agreed. But before we get to the happy ending, a bunch of shit pops off.
Yes.
So we end up back at the dorm, and this is when I think Harry has to pretend to be like a pizza delivery guy to get into the building because they're locked, and some like stoner kid just opens the door without even a question.
Yep.
Because that shit is real, y'all. That's how I got into all the dorms.
I mean, that's like the only, even if you like forget your keys and shit, you have to depend that there's just going to be somebody who's like really just not.
And there always concerned. Is.
Yep.
There
yep.
always was. So, and he gets up there, and that's when he realizes that the father is doing the thing where he's exerting his energy and his will.
On the whole floor.
On the whole floor. Like, the whole floor is just like an unfortunate consequence. Like, you know, he's directing it towards Connie, but it is just bouncing off of all the walls and so all the kids. Connie. So like all the poor unfortunate people that happen to be around are just like banging everything and everyone that they get their hands on, and Connie is Harry is so awkward talking about this, but basically Connie is fucking the life out of Irwin, and there's nothing that can be done. Like, Harry is trying to call them, like, call their names to, like, snap them out of it.
Nope.
It is not working.
Listen, I remember being that age. It wouldn't even have taken magic. You wouldn't have snapped me out of that shit either.
You could have came and poured a bucket of ice water on top of me, and I wouldn't have fucking cared. Yep. And,
I love when he comes in and says, do you know a guy named Irwin Pounder? And the kid just goes,
Pounder.
Listen, we were all thinking it.
We really were. So, I think, what happens? I think, the ghouls come and, the father bangs Harry on the back of his head, right?
And then when Harry wakes up, he's got those,
those zip tie things.
Zip tie, thank you. And he's like, yeah, I'm just going to put you right there, and you can sit tight. And then when she's done with him, she'll have you for dessert. And he's okay, cool, shit.
Does not look good.
Also, Harry says when he wakes up that his jeans are a few sizes too
small. Oh, listen, I was not going to talk about that. I was just going to skip right over that because I was uncomfortable.
Oh, I find it so funny whenever Harry Dresden, he will talk about women's bodies. He will talk about, being full of need or whatever language he feels like using. But when it just comes to straight up, dick jokes, that's a lot rarer, and he seems so uncomfortable with them, and I just find that shit amusing as hell. I really enjoy it. So, yeah, Harry is talking to him about the fact that, first of all, he tries to be like, well, the White Council's going to come after you, the Wraiths are going to come after you, and he's just unconcerned.
Yeah,
her
not
dad
at all.
Is just like, they aren't going to find out shit. I think we both know that the, White Council has a better reputation than they probably deserve.
Shots fired.
And Harry's like, fuck, because that's exactly right. And as far as the Wraiths, he's just like, they're not going to find out because there's not going to be any fucking bodies left. So this is why I have ghouls to take care of that shit. Which didn't even occur to me. The idea of, because for some reason, I always think of, them evaporating after they're done feeding on them. They're just
dead. Right, right, but right. There's
no,
nothing
they
left.
Just, fall dead as a body, and then they have to dump them. That was what the deeps were for, was for, body disposal. But yeah, so he says, let's see. I have friends, too, perhaps, Dresden, but your friends are not here. And this is when a black Lincoln Town Car comes crashing through the dorm's door. The ghouls holding me down were scattered by the debris, and fine dust filled the air. The car had crossed the hall and wound up with its bumper and front tires resting inside Irwin's room. It had smashed a massive hole in the outer brick wall of the building, leaving it gaping open to the night. That got everyone's attention. And this is when somebody jumps up, and by somebody, I mean obviously River Shoulders, because there's not a soul else that is this size.
Right, right.
Smacks a hand on the floor and lets this sound out. And then this power comes rippling out.
Right.
In this, subsonic whoom.
Yeah.
And everything goes still.
And Harry is
just like,
yeah, the fuck what? Is this shit? Harry has felt some power in his life. He's been in some situations.
Mm-hmm.
I think earlier in the story, or maybe it's right around this point, he talks about having not felt this power since the last time he was next to Ebenezer when he was about to do a spell, which I'm assuming is, from
when
changes.
He was a teenager?
Or maybe.
Maybe it was change. Well, changes didn't happen
yet. Yeah, this is before changes, so I guess it is from when he was a kid. But yeah. He makes a reference to Ebenezer when he talks about the power that he felt. Mm-hmm. And he also mentions that he felt a lot of power around Irwin earlier.
Yeah.
And just being like, this kid is fucking wired.
Yeah.
You know, to something that is serious.
And when he goes and talks to River Shoulders again, he's like, I don't feel that coming off you. You wouldn't happen to be tamping that down a little bit, would you? River Shoulders is like, I don't know what you mean, tiny human man.
and also mind your business.
That's like, oh my God, I've told this story about asking my dad if he'd ever killed anybody.
Uh-huh.
And him just responding with, you ask too many questions. And that's what River Shoulder says. You ask too many questions. Oh, shit.
So River Shoulders is on the scene now, and the whole game has changed. Mm-hmm. He gets, piled by a bunch of ghouls, and he just, shakes them off like fleas. Yep. Which is, impressive and hard to do. And it's so impressive that when Rivers is like, take your fucking master and get the fuck out of my face, they're like, yes, we will do that. And this is why there are no bodies. You know, there's blood everywhere, but there are no bodies because they grabbed him, they grabbed what was left of their friends, and they bounced. And I'm just like, I need Rivers to be in the main books.
I know,
right? Why isn't that a thing that's happening?
I also really like the distinction that Harry makes about how he didn't destroy Barrowell's assault, because destroying things is pretty simple, actually.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
He brought everything back to stillness, and he compares that to, stopping water rippling after you throw a rock in a lake, and how it's practically an impossible thing to do.
A whole other level of magic
that
Harry doesn't even, he can't do anything but just watch it.
Mm-hmm.
And just, and recognize that it is something that is so beyond him,
Mm-hmm.
Right? It's a lot.
I had a lot of, misgivings about how Irwin's mom could bang a Bigfoot. And, I still have them, mostly anatomically.
Right. There's a little line about her in this, isn't it? When they talk about how she's built like a linebacker.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Because he mentioned how big she was. But yeah, when you see him do this kind of display of power, I'm kind of like, oh, okay.
Oh, I get it. You
know what? I get it.
Yeah, I get it. So he's a little hairy. It's fine.
That's fine. That one's a little hairy.
And you know, Rivers has got that BDE too.
Oh my God, definitely.
And if I remember correctly, Irwin's mom, not only because of her physical, but she's also very, very intelligent.
Mm-hmm.
She had not had a lot of luck with I guess regular men. I don't know how to say that. Human men. You know, they were either intimidated by her size or intimidated by her intellect. So when she meets Rivers, who is not intimidated at all and is carrying all of this self-assuredness and this energy, I see why you want to get down with that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, especially after a lifetime of disappointed with regular old fucking raggedy ass men. You know?
I don't know why raggedy ass always makes me laugh. I have heard it so many times, you'd really think it had lost its charm for me by now, but it has not. It will always make me break out in the giggles. I just especially in a Twitter thread, and somebody will try and come for somebody else, and then you just see somebody post a gif of a sarcastic face, and it'll just say, "What's your raggedy ass?" And I just fall out every time. You don't even need to make a good argument. That's all you need to say, and I'm just gonna be like, "Yeah, you're right, though."
So finally, what's happening with Connie and Irwin is disrupted, and this is
fight.
Yeah,
fight.
Basically, Irwin he doesn't snap out of it because he's still kind of dazed and not him his whole self,
mm-hmm.
but he recognizes the danger that Connie is in.
Right.
And he fucking goes after her father. And he's about to kill this motherfucker.
He's about to bash his head in.
Yeah, he is beating the fuck out of this dude, and I was not mad at all.
Not a bit.
And because Bear Hill, when shit starts to go on left, he takes his daughter and tries to, like, leave and runs away. And then that turns into a whole thing. And when they finally get him, she has to just kind of be like, she asks him to stop. And she's like, he's still my father.
Mm-hmm. He's still my daddy.
Yeah.
And like, no, though.
Because Harry is yelling at him to stop because he doesn't want him to kill him. And I don't know if Rivers is saying anything in this moment, but I don't think he is.
I think he's a little distracted at this time.
With the ghouls and shit, right?
Yeah.
But Connie says to him, you know, don't do it. And he's like, you know, he's doing this thing too where Irwin is now talking in this weird, stilted way.
Mm-hmm.
And he's just like, you know, he tried to hurt you. And she's like, this isn't the way. He says, this is a bad man. And he says, she says, but you aren't. You aren't a bad man. And then, you know, he's still my dad. And she's able to calm him down.
Yeah.
And he stops.
I love how hard he was ready to go.
He was gonna fuck this man.
I don't care. I'll lay him out. It's fine.
He was gonna fuck his whole shit up.
And I enjoy Harry's train of thought as well, because he's not like, don't kill him, kid. You won't be able to live with yourself. He's like, don't kill him. This is going to get politically very complicated. There's no like, oh, he doesn't deserve to die or preserve the life. No, none of that.
This is going to get like, messy.
You don't want that headache. Oh, the paperwork.
Right. Basically, it all comes down to that, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So Irwin, like, calms down and, like, kind of, like, collapses into Connie's arms, and she's consoling him that, you know, it's over now, that they're safe. And it cuts back to Harry talking to the officer, and this is when the cop is just like, so you got some holes in this story.
Oh my God, this cop. He's just trying to humor him. At one point, he, like, interrupts, and Harry's like, do you want to hear this or not? And he's like, oh, I definitely
want to hear this. This is the best shit I've heard since I cornered that meth head or whatever the fuck it was. So, he also asks Harry, you know, they're gone. The kids are gone. They're not officially missing, but no one's seen them. I don't suppose you know where they are. And Harry's just like, I don't know.
I have no idea who. Not familiar. So let me go back into Irwin ripped in a towel.
Oh, and he puts this like blanket over her.
I'm just like,
The towel is barely covering him, but it's fine. We're all adults here.
Harry's even like, damn. He sees him in the towel. He's like, that is doing a lot for him.
And we finally get the moment where Rivers actually meets Irwin.
Mm-hmm.
And he comes and he introduces himself as Irwin is still trying to, like, clear his head and, like, get back to himself. And Connie is saying she remembers everything that happened. And she's looking at Rivers, and she's like, you stopped something terrible from happening.
Mm-hmm.
And Harry is like, yeah, he did. And she goes to thank him, and she asks who he is, and he and Rivers says, I'm Irwin's dad. And Irwin is standing there like, what? And we get them meeting each other. And I thought that this was really well done because I know in our popular imagination, sometimes we think that these moments, you know, these long lost people getting together finally should be like overly sentimental, you know, or overly emotional. In my personal experience, it doesn't work that way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I love that this is presented in such a way that Irwin is like, yeah, it's awesome to meet you. And Rivers is like, I thought it would be different. I thought maybe we'd go someplace nice and have dinner and have some music. Which is really adorable because, Bigfoot, where are you going for dinner?
Right. I also had that question. I assume that this means like someplace maybe on the res that they would have,
gotta be.
I was like, what are you talking about? There's a really nice jazz club downtown that I would love to take you to.
But it's a really cute moment. And there's this wonderful moment. Oh, okay. We also get Irwin talking about, like, he's saying to his father and to Harry that Connie, he's saying Connie's a vampire, isn't she? Mm-hmm. And he says, again, the paranet, dude. It's the whole goddamn page.
Like, I love that.
Like, you really need to get on the internet. And there's just, like, a sweet moment of just kind of being, like, why Irwin asks the most important question, the only question, which is, like, why?
Why?
Why have you been gone, you know? And it turns out that Rivers says that, you know, in his people's tradition, you know, if they had known about him, they would have insisted he be raised a very certain way. And that there are certain traditions that would have had to have been observed. He doesn't go into detail. But he says, I didn't want those constraints on you. I wanted you to be whatever your life was going to be. I wanted your world to be wider than mine. And that's a really beautiful thing to say that, in my opinion, means nothing in the moment of when you're asking your parent, where have they been?
Yeah.
And
it is the kind of thing that, like, intellectually, I'm like, okay, I get it. But really, what the fuck?
It's not satisfying.
Yeah.
And Irwin says to him, okay, well, tonight, like, shed some light on some shit. But we're not done, okay? We're not done. And I love that. I love it so much. And then this is when they decide, you know, they got to bounce. Rivers got to get out of town because he cannot just be a Bigfoot on the scene of the crime. And Connie and Irwin have to go because, obviously... And they say that Harry's going to stay and deal with the aftermath of all this. And Harry's like, yeah, this is what I do. It's fine.
And I love the way it says, Irwin took his father's hand, one arm still around Connie, and the three of them didn't vanish so much as just become less and less relevant to the situation.
Yeah, I like that.
Wild, right?
Yeah. The same nebulous, somehow transparent power that River had used earlier enfolded them, and then they were all gone. Yeah, I like that a lot. Also, because we still don't have an understanding of what River's power and how his magic works, you know? So yeah, that's really cool.
I like the vague idea that, like, the Bigfoots are just in plain sight with magic that just hides them.
I do, too. And I think Harry said something about that earlier when he's talking about how over the years people keep claiming they see them, but no one's ever been able to actually catch them. I don't know if he's talking to Rivers when he says it or when he's talking to the cop.
I think he's talking to the cop. Yeah.
But, yeah. And, then it just wraps back around to him talking to the cop again, like, well, there's a story. And the cop is just like, all right, you're drunk or high or something. You're going to go sleep it off. I'm going to give you some aspirin. And we're going to call it a night.
I love that Harry's just like, God damn it. Why did I not take that fucking gold?
Right?
I should have taken that shit.
And he's so happy for that aspirin, too.
Yep.
And he's just waiting for his homeboy to come bail him out the next morning. The guy with the car, Wild Bill.
I really need Dresden to start taking payment. Just in general more often. He's out here turning down money left and right, and he can't even keep a roof over his head.
Exactly. Shit. Like, as far as we know right now, after changes, this motherfucker doesn't have a place to live, and he's just throwing gold nuggets back at people. You need to get your life together. Meanwhile, I'm talking about putting my cash on Facebook, and I didn't even do it. So,
oh my God, true.
I'm a liar.
Everybody,
don't listen to me.
Go give RoShawn money. What is it? $
My cash app.
Rodilo?
Yeah, $RO DI LO.
All right, there you go, guys. Give RoShawn some money.
Send me some money, because it's hard out here dealing with people.
Oh God. But yeah, I understand wanting to make that bargain. It's interesting. What do you think about Harry like making these conditions for the
I think it is exactly what our Harry Dresden would do. You know? Mm-hmm. Like, he's taken two cases and taken payment for two cases dealing with Irwin. Right. And Rivers. But it is to a point now where he's starting to feel like, look, you can't just keep calling me when what is needed is your presence is needed. Right. Like I'm here to help in whatever way I can, right? As a wizard, I'm down to help keep your family and your son safe. But I'm not a substitute for your mm-hmm. presence. And, you know, it feels to me right in line with what we know about Harry, that at this point, he would be like, okay, no.
Yeah. Drawing a line, finally.
Yeah, it just feels right to me.
Yeah, it's in the intro, Butcher calls it somewhat arrogant. Mm-hmm. Which it is, I guess.
I guess it's arrogant to, like, assume that you get to dictate, you know, when a father is going to deal with his child.
Mm-hmm.
But again, this is not the first time he's been called by Rivers to help Irwin.
Yeah.
You know, and I feel like at this point, someone needed to say that to him. And who else was going to do it?
Yeah, right. Exactly. Who else was there?
Yeah. You know, that's where we find Harry more often than not. Is who else? You know, who else is going to do it? It's just kind of his role.
I wanted to mention, because Brendan Hone, he sent me a bunch of messages tonight. First, he started off and he says, "Sorry, I haven't sent you the notes for the short stories yet. This week got away from me." Brendan, yeah. Please. Don't worry about it. I really appreciate you doing it, but please do not stress over it. I don't want you to stress.
It got away from all of us, Brendan. Don't feel bad.
Right. But he mentions, because we asked about whether Mark Hone, like, showed up in Changes. We were trying to remember if he did. And he reminded us that Mark Hone met Harry at McDonald's and was the one who taught him to meet Vatterung.
Oh, right.
He, like, got his friend guard to take him.
Yep.
And let's see. Oh my God, there's something else that I think I'm going to keep to myself. It was a good idea though, Brendan. I like where you're going with that. But it's a bit of a tease in a direction that I'm not sure I even want to go at this time, because it's not exactly spoilery, but it might put ideas in your head. That's all I'm saying. And he gave us notes for Bigfoot on Campus. He did a really good job of explaining everything in that one. Not much I can add. Inari is the other nascent White Court vampire. We've seen Lord Wraith try to arrange for her to accidentally kill Harry. Oh, cool. Yeah, this is what I mentioned. But Mouse as a puppy interrupted things. I did not remember that Mouse was the one who rescued Harry in that one, though.
Oh.
That's adorable. Later, Inari and her boyfriend both got injured to the point where they won't be able to get physical until they recover, and by that point they'll be in love when they consummate their relationship, which will kill the hunger inside of her before it has a chance to take over.
Hmm.
Which, I wonder...
Can
I
we guess do that? That?
Well, that is something that apparently is, like, super rare, but that is something that Thomas describes to Harry when he's explaining what happened with Inari.
Oh, right.
So it's like, love is anathema to the hunger. But if the hunger gets a chance to get its hooks in you before you fall in love, what that anathema means is that you'll be burned by contact with anything relevant to pure love. Remember?
Fuck, that's right.
So like white court vampires, their skin blisters like they've been burned basically right. When they're in contact with a person who is in love.
Huh.
But if it happens before the hunger is fully formed, I guess, or born, or I don't right. know how to put it, it kills it.
Doesn't at one point Rivers calls the demon the Wendigo, which is, mm-hmm. I meant to look it up because that was a creature that they fought on Supernatural. You guys hear me reference Supernatural all the time on these podcasts because they've been on for 45 years and they've just covered everything. I meant to look it up to see what that monster was in their universe, but I forgot to
do it. Yeah, I'll look it up now because, in their universe, I don't know. But let me see. Wendigo Dresden Files, I'll just give it a shot. Because I am very, when I was a kid, I've read a lot of, myths and things. And the Wendigo was something that came up for some of the scary stories that I was into. And they were, basically, they ate people.
That's what it was in Supernatural. They were, they would lure people down to, these underground things and then just, eat their flesh. Kind of like ghouls, but
yeah,
not quite.
Yeah. According to legend, a Wendigo was a human once, one who performed dark acts like cannibalism. Someone let me know if I'm wrong, and Dresden verse Wendigos do fall in here. Yeah, interesting. I am not going to read that because that's spoilery, but yeah. So, not clear. But if anybody has further information, like perhaps Brennan Holm, let me know. So White Love Hurts is one of the other stories that I'm not entirely certain I care enough to cover. I feel like it's probably just good policy to cover all of them. For those who are interested, the stories that are on the docket other than this one are Love Hurts, Even Hand, and there was another one. Forgive me, guys. I'm going to have to look into it. But I have to check and see how long they are, because this one's long. So it was fine to just do this one for a whole episode. But we may be able to cut down the time a little bit by putting two stories together for an episode and talking about both in one shot. So I will look into it and see, if they are a little bit shorter. Love Hurts, it's like one of those stories that I'm not even trying to say it wasn't a good story. But I don't remember it particularly, which makes me feel like it probably doesn't matter that much. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
But I may be wrong about that.
Well, yeah, let me know what you find. Because I'm not going to... I'm tempted to go looking, but I won't.
Don't do it.
I won't do it.
Love Hurts, Even Hand, Aftermath. That's the other one. Aftermath. And... I think that's it. So, and I wanted to let you all know too that I'm going to be taking. What are you doing over there?
Sorry,
that is loud as fuck.
Is it really?
Yeah, I think you go and go get your book and light your cigarette and stuff while I'm doing the intro. You have no idea. I can hear every single thing you're doing, all of it.
I really did have no idea. I was just getting my trash together just for collecting around the computer.
This shit is
oh my god, I'm so sorry.
So I'm going to be taking the week of my birthday off from recording. My birthday's October 1st. And everybody's having to skip their birthdays because of the pandemic. And for me, what I'm going to do is just take a little vacation. I can't go anywhere, but that's fine. I'll just take a little time off. It'd be great.
Take a little, what do they call that?
Staycation.
Mm-hmm. I think I might take one too, because I had off for the wedding right? It had like, you know, eight or 9 days or whatever. And now I don't need that. So maybe I'll take me a little staycation around the same time.
Nice. Yeah. I mean, Owen and I will be taking the time off anyway because we've decided to go to a little cabin during the wedding dates.
Oh, God. You're so lucky.
I won't be around for, even though the wedding has been postponed, I still won't be around for it.
So. That's awesome.
You could do a little one. You do an Airbnb. It's cheap right now.
I keep trying. I'm not having any luck with that. Can't leave the cats home.
Oh, the cats.
You have cats that you don't see mine leaving at home.
They're fine. Well, we have people around that can feed them. Owen's grandma pops over and stuff, you know.
Okay.
But yeah, so I just wanted to let you guys know that the second week in, like the first week in October is a week that I'm taking off, but there will be episodes posted from the previous week's recordings.
Right, right.
It will be the second week of October that there will be nothing up. When's I just wanted to alert you all.
When's that, when's the drawing going up? The Song of Ice and Fire drawing going up?
By the time this is up, that will have already gone up the previous Monday.
Woohoo!
So it should be up. So everybody who's been waiting for Song of Ice and Fire, that shit is commenced, I guess is the word I want.
Sure, why not?
It sounds has official. Commenced. So yeah, guys, I hope that you all enjoy that. And I'm going to put a little plug at the beginning of this episode. My mom has a project that she's working on because my mom is going to take some monastic vows.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. It's not like she's joining a monastery officially because it's all from home.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But she's doing this thing with a YouTube channel where she's talking about like the divine feminine and the manifestation of like feminine deities in different cultures and
right.
How they compare within different mythologies and different traditions and stuff.
That sounds really interesting.
Yeah. And she found this order because she does a lot of research on trying to find groups that seem to like jive with what she's thinking of. And she found this order called the Order of the Black Madonna.
Oh, I know about that.
Yeah. And so that's something that she's been very into and she is just dipping her toe into starting like a channel and is very unsure of what she's doing so far, but she just kind of wanted to get something rolling. So I'm going to post the link to her project and let you guys all, if you want to check it out, if that's something that interests you, be nice because she's my mommy.
Yes, be nice.
And don't make us, her.
Don't make us drag you. We'll do it.
We will do it. And, you know, if you like her, give her a subscription, leave her some comments. She's in the beginning stages. And when you first start something like this, every single comment is like a little gold nugget that you just cherish in your hand.
Yeah. It's so, why I haven't started any projects of my own. Cause I just, you know, it's overwhelming and it's intimidating and it's scary. Mm-hmm. So good for her for putting herself out there. That's awesome.
Yeah, agreed. See, the other day she was like, I lost some subscribers. I think I want to bail. And I was like, Mom. Aww. It's been 2 weeks.
Calm down. That's so adorable. I'm going to go find it and like it. So, yeah, definitely do that.
Yay.
Link so we can all do that.
All right, everybody. Well, thank you again so much for listening. We love you. Thank you again, Brendan Hone, for all you do to contribute and fact check us and whatnot. And you guys know where to find us, facebook.com. Oh, don't go to Facebook. You know what? They've banned me. I can't even post from that fucking page right now. Fuck them. Go to twitter.com/unspoiledshow, Instagram at Unspoiled Podcast, or just become a patron and go in the Mighty Network. I'm in the Mighty Network. That's the place to find me. Or you can email me at unspoiledpodcast@gmail.com. But Facebook is just, they can suck my dick right now. Ah, so irritated. Anyway. We love you, and we'll see you next week. Until then, toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Bye, guys. I'll give you the sensations of freedom.
Unspoiled Network Podcast.